the first question, our first thing is, we have started with EC2. EC2 instance is nothing but a server which we create in the cloud, a virtual server. But, you know, when we are trying to launch a server in the cloud, we must need it. You are able to hear me now. Sorry, there is a little disturbance with the network actually. So under EC2 instances, we have first discussed about keybase. Is nothing but it's a private key, okay, used to launch an instance. It acts like a key, and with respect to this, we authenticate ourselves that yes, we are the people who wanted to access that. So that is what the key pair. We have seen how to create a key pair, then how to convert it from one format to another format. Basically, when we first create, it will be downloaded into one format. Can you just tell me what format we usually get that key pair once created?
Yeah, sir.
Sorry?
PEM.
Yeah, .pem format we usually get, and that .pem format key pair we convert into PPK format. It's just because, do you know what's the reason? The reason for that is when we are trying to connect, okay, launching an instance is fine, and after once we launch an instance here in our cloud, we try to connect, when we try to connect to that instance, okay, from a Windows machine, but suppose this is my laptop and having Windows OS in it, from this Windows OS machine, I'm trying to connect, okay, to a Linux machine that is nothing but the instance which we create in the cloud. Since these two OS are different from each other, we needed PPK format key pair. In case, if you are trying to connect to an instance which is created in the cloud from a local machine, and if both of these servers, instance and your local machine, both of these machines, OS is same, Windows to Windows or Linux to Linux, then .pem format is enough for us. So that is the thing about key pairs. So we have seen how to create key pairs and all. Let me create another one because this is my fresh account which I've just recently created, as my older account has got expired. So I'm going to create one now. I'll just give the same name though. So by default it has got downloaded, and then that is downloaded into .pem format. So this is all about key pair. We'll convert that into PPK when it is needed. Then after that we have discussed about security group. You remember in yesterday's class when I was trying to launch an instance and after that installed the Apache server, a web server into that, and created a web page, a basic web page that's index.html, and when we try to connect over internet, we could not get it. I did a little simple thing, and I just skipped, missed something that we will see today. Okay, So that's about after key pair, we have gone to security groups and discussed something about security group. So what security group? Security group is nothing but a virtual firewall which is created to our server. As I said, AWS is a public cloud, okay? And in this public cloud, whenever we create our servers, to safeguard them, we should have some security parameters so that these security groups are created. And security groups will have inbound and outbound traffic which we have to set, okay? So based on that, we will be able to connect to our instances. And security group is nothing but what? It's a virtual firewall, and key pair is nothing but a private key which communicate with the public key which is with the instance. So public will have, sorry, instance will have public key, and to access that we need to have a private key. That's what we have done. And remember, whenever we create a security group, of course I'll discuss about this a little later and in detail, but for now understand security group is stateful, which means whenever you do some changes in the security group, that will be affected on the spot. So from the moment you change it. So that is why we say security groups are stateful, and whenever you are trying to create a new security group, let's say I'll create now a security group SG. Description also I'll give the name. And inbound, by default you will be getting a security group which is very plain without any access. So everything we need to set inbound. What do you mean by inbound traffic? Inbound is nothing but, as I said, security group is a virtual firewall. Firewall is nothing but it's like a wall around our server which protect us, or which safeguard our server, who can enter into our server, who can connect to our server, who can access it. So to define that, you know, people always, you know, communicate or connect or access these servers through a certain port number. Okay, in real-time scenarios, when we wanted to connect to a Windows server, we usually go to run mode and type MSC SC. With this, you know, we'll get a remote desktop connection, RDP we say. Here you give your server name and then say connect. If it is a Windows machine, when you wanted to connect a remote Windows machine from your local machine, this is how we do in real time. But when it is a Linux machine or any Unix machine, and when you wanted to connect to that from your local machine, what do? We just go to PuTTY. This is a small, simple application which we get in the Google. It's a freeware, a very simple and small, so small file. You can just download if you don't have it, and then have it. So here you give your, if it is a Unix machine, so through this PuTTY session we connect. But if you just look and observe, see here it is selected SSH, okay, and the port number is 22. So everything will have a port number. Through that port, they will be able to access. So in this inbound, okay, which is very plain, which will not provide you any access, will have to set by your own self. And this is what we missed yesterday. Okay, what we missed yesterday, why couldn't we connect our web server? It's because we did not, you know, set our security group to access our server over internet. We have only taken one inbound or one port, that's, you know, port number 22, so we could able to connect through PuTTY and access that server. But over internet, when you wanted to connect, okay, for now let it be anywhere. This is another security reason. You're not supposed to go with anywhere, because it will be accessed by public using this port number 22. If somebody gets the public IP address of your instance created, then they'll be able to connect using port number 22, because you have given the source to anywhere, and the IP address can be any IP address can communicate your access your server. And what we have to do, I'll just do that and show you. Now outbound, inbound is nothing but who can access your instance. Outbound is nothing but with whom your instance can communicate or access. So by default, like I said, inbound traffic is not assigned, or by default it is very plain, you will not have any access. Outbound is by default be provided for all the port ranges. So this is what you can see here, all traffic, all protocols, the port range from zero to so number, and anyway, so from your instance, whichever has this security group, it's not only that, any security group, once you create, you will be getting outbound traffic. Okay, by default be provided to access anything, all the port ranges available. So that's what the security group, you know, understand that. Now I'm just creating it. So done with security group also. Let's name this security group with the same. Okay. Now, after this, we have seen instances. The instances are different type of instances we have seen with respect to the pricing model and with respect to, you know, the configurational stuff. We have seen so many things under that, and after EC2 instances, you know, launched, we have also started learning about or discussed about volumes. So this is where, till this point, we have discussed and stopped at last. Now, my question is, can you please tell me, okay, you have any doubts in launching an instance or any parameter in that, you know, launch configurations and all? If not, the next question is, what about volumes? What about yesterday's class? How far you could able to understand yesterday's class? So if you can just tell me what you are having a doubt with, we'll just continue from there, or okay, I'll just go ahead with the next topic. Please drop your inputs, or you can also tell me directly, because there are a couple of guys for whom it is not so very clear, like one guy could not join to our class yesterday because of the network issues, because here we are having a lot of network issues due to uncertain rains, and Shilpa has to leave in the middle because of her office timings. Okay, so if you can just tell me, anybody, if you can tell me, we'll start from there. Okay,
so launching an instance,
Rajita, please.
For launching an instance, I didn't find any problem, but for the volume and the smart chart, that was like confusing for me.
Don't worry, we did not discuss anything about snapshot. We have only seen about volumes. So I will do that. I'll just clarify all your doubts.
Because for the Linux, I don't have any idea in Linux, so I don't know which command to use, which command not to use. So
I'll clearly tell you. That's why I said yesterday's class was a bit lengthy. That's you know, more than usual. And we have seen lots of things yesterday. We have created a server, you know, launched an instance, then did so many things. So I'll just tell you all those things again. That's fine. Okay. Every single command, I'll explain what command it is and what for it is used. Not to worry. Anything else?
Okay, thank you.
So you don't have any issues with launching an instance?
No, I didn't find any problem launching an instance.
That's fantastic. So, and one more question. Am I audible to everybody?
Yes.
Yeah. So now let's see, quickly we'll launch an instance, and then we'll continue from where we have started yesterday, or where, from where, you know, it was little confusing. So today's class would be something like, you know, it's recapitulating everything whatever we have discussed so far. I don't think we will be learning something new today, but let's concrete ourselves with what and all the discussions we had so far. Let's make things very clear. Okay, and if time permits, okay, I I'm just planning to end up our sessions at most by 9 o'clock from today, so that no one will have an issue with staying for a longer period of time and all. Unless if the topic is really, really important and it's taking time and you are okay, okay, fine. Maybe for 5 to 10 minutes I may extend, but not more than that. So let's see. We'll go and create a launch an instance. So now I'm just going to do that. And yeah, can you just tell me what is an AMI?
Amazon Methane Image.
Yeah, that's fine. That's an abbreviation, of course. But what it is actually? AMI stands for Amazon Machine Image. To build the server, find any other bundle of pre-installed. Yes, that's pretty good answer. Anybody else? Any inputs? This is good. I'm happy that you are responding to things, which makes our sessions healthy. The interactive mode sessions will be healthy all the time. So I've got multiple answers, but only from three to four guys. So rest of the guys, I wanted, please drop your input so that I'll understand how far you're able to understand. Okay, anybody else? Any other answers? My question is, what's AMI?
Yeah, it already has supporting software for already installed in AMI.
That's fine. Looks like you are, clear with that. So I'll tell you. Okay, your answers are fine. Pretty good. AMI is nothing but, as I said, okay, I also got the answer from you, that it is a pre-bundled configured image. If you just look at this Amazon Linux AMI, it has Amazon Linux AMI with EBS backed. We'll understand what's EBS. We have seen, but we will understand again what is EBS backed and instance store and AWS supported image. First thing, okay, before I go with that, I just wanted to be, see, when you purchase a laptop, will you be able to, like, you go pay money, get the laptop and then start using it? Will that be done? It's not possible, right? So what we have to do, first you go to a person who can install OS into that. That may be Windows 8 or Windows 7, Windows 10, whatever it is. We usually, you know, habituated using our system with that, right? So that's what operating system OS. So first we need to install that. Once that is done, okay, we again have to, you know, install all the drivers. That may be a volume driver, you know, any other, all the stuff, all the supporting drivers. And after that is done, we go install all the other applications and softwares which we require. Maybe, you know, a video player, maybe an application like, you know, you wanted to practice some Linux kind of stuff or any other, you know, technology, then you may require some a VM. Okay, so VM box or something like that, you install that and then you do a lot of stuff. So to make your system ready for your usage, you at least have to spend couple of hours, right? So installing OS into that and all the softwares and all, till then it gets ready for your usage, it will take some 3 to 4 hours or at least couple of hours. But here in cloud, we are able to launch an instance on the spot just like that in a matter of minute or less than a minute. It is possible with respect to AMI. So that AMI will have all the softwares, okay, pre-installed, pre-bundled configured softwares, a package of, you know, applications and OS and all the other softwares is together known as Amazon Machine Image AMI. So here in Amazon Linux AMI, we have AWS command line tool, Python, Ruby, Perl, Java, and all we have apart from Linux. So Linux is the OS. With respect to that, we are going to have all these additional applications installed by itself. Yeah, you can customize. AMIs can be customized. How do you customize? Not these AMIs which are available, but once you build your applications, your server, your instance in the cloud, after once all the applications are installed, you can just go and create your own AMI. Your own AMI, that is possible, so that whenever you wanted to launch an instance which is similar to, you know, which will be readily used for your production, then of course your AMIs will work. So this is where AMI tab, here we go and see how to create an AMI. Okay, we will see that. That is discussed practically, not to worry. Now, so that's what AMI we will be going, and here AMIs will have two different types. In bracket you have HVM, which is nothing but hardware virtual machine, and somewhere you will find PV, which is nothing but para virtualization. So these are different type of virtualizations. Okay, you no need to, you know, remember these are, it's not so very important, but just to have an idea I'm discussing that. Yeah, here you see you have PV in the brackets, which is nothing but, which is para virtualized. HVM is nothing but hardware virtual machine. So that's what you remember. But whenever you are playing, please always play with the free tier eligible things only. So this is my practice. I always go with Amazon Linux AMI because it will have all the needful softwares or applications. So selected, and the eligible thing is T2 Micro. So we have created, it is already selected. This is where you can just get the list of our different type of instances in terms of their configuration. It's nothing but configuration is nothing but what? Number of vCPUs, its RAM, number of gigabytes, and whether it is supported for EBS or not, network performance, then whether it is instance storage or EBS only. Okay, here EBS only, and this is instance storage. Instance storage is nothing but, you don't need to have additional EBS volume for these instances once you take. Automatically, with respect to the instance you create, you will have some amount of space allocated to that, and you can utilize that, not an issue. But rest all, see this from M4 to above, all the above instances by default needed EBS. They do not have, these instances will not have any storage inbuilt in them. We must have to go and take an additional EBS volume. That's the reason why the next tab here in storage, okay, we will have an 8 gigabytes of storage added by default. That's the one. And what we have seen, now how many number of instances you wanted to create. If you wanted more than one instance at a time, okay, you can just go and give it. Then if you wanted to purchase a spot instance, then you can go and bid here by checking this. Okay, then VPC, a virtual private cloud, to, you know, dedicate or isolate your network so that only you can communicate or access your servers. But we are now currently going with the default VPC only, not an issue. We will see, we still will be discussing about VPC in a separate class. Then for now you understand subnet. Subnet is nothing but what? And anything you have a doubt with, and you wanted to understand what it is, you find I just beside that and just go place your cursor on top of that, you'll understand. A range of IP address. Subnet is what? A range of IP addresses in your VPC that can be used to isolate different EC2 resources from each other or from the internet. Each subnet resides in one availability zone. Okay, so for now, okay, don't worry, we will discuss about this in detail when we are going to discuss about VPC. But for now, understand subnet is nothing but availability zone. So each subnet acts like an availability zone. What do you mean by an availability zone? there may be a question asked, what is the difference between region and availability zone? Can you just tell me what is meant by region and availability zone? Anybody? What is region and what is availability zone? Nobody?
Regions, we do have 10 regions, separate regions. One can access any instance from any region.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then what is availability zone?
I'm not sure about availability zone.
Yes, thanks for your input. Because I wanted to understand what far you are able to, you're getting things. So, okay, fine. Anybody else who can tell me what is region and what is availability zone? Rest, guys, please be interactive as I said. If you have any confusion, then you also let me know. I'll just clarify it. If you don't know, you can just directly tell me you do not know. Okay, so understand. No, not strict. It's not that strict. 10 data centers are zone. No, it's not that. Understand this way. So you see, we are currently in Sydney region. So as Rajita said, there are 10 regions. So the 10 regions are nothing but 10 geographic locations across the globe. What Amazon has does is, Amazon wanted to serve all the people and capture entire globe to provide or, to do their business in terms of cloud services. In order to do that, it has decided to, provide comfortability to all the people so that they need not to come anywhere or go anywhere to create their infrastructures. If a person belongs to, a packed region that may be Tokyo or anything, Asia or Asia region, that person can go and create his infrastructure in all these four things so that there will be a less latency and people can directly access that based on your client and all. So geographic location, it's a geographic location is nothing but a region. A region is nothing but a spot or a location where Amazon has its data centers built in. Okay, and each region, understand, each region has minimum of 2 availability zones. Okay, each region has minimum of 2 availability zones. On the whole, there are 10 regions. So what is availability zone now? So availability zone is nothing but a data center. So each region, as I said, each region has 2 to 3, or some regions also have 4 data centers, 4 availability zones. So here in this case, understand, one subnet is nothing but one availability zone, and one availability zone is nothing but one data center in the cloud in Amazon. And the combination of 2 or more data centers together is one region. Hope that makes sense. You clear with that? Yes?
Yes.
So understand, region is nothing but it's a location where Amazon has its data centers. Okay, and availability zone is nothing but it's a simply a data center. Each region has minimum of 2 data centers or 2 availability zones. Now, what do you mean by data center? It is just a combination of, a server, a storage, or database, or anything you wanted for an infrastructure. All that when, framed together or when established together, that will be a data center. So here under subnet, we, specify which data center you wanted to launch your instance. If you do not have any such preferences, then you leave it for the default. But if you wanted specifically to launch your instance in either of these three, now we are in Sydney, so Sydney has 3 availability zones, which means 3 data centers. So it's up to you. and you wanted to create a new data center, that is also possible under your own VPC. Okay, so that is a point. Then public IP. This public IP, as I said, every instance will have two IP addresses, private IP address and public IP address. Why do we use these IP addresses? To connect to the servers or instances. So the IP addresses are useful for us to connect to them. And when you wanted to connect from external world, your instance must need to have a public IP. Okay, if you do not take a public IP, you will not be able to communicate or access that from the external world. And with the private IP within the network, you'll be able to access that. Okay, just a second. Okay. So that's what, and by default, since we are creating this instance in a default VPC, so it is the default thing is enable, your public IP will be enabled unless if you want it to disable. Okay, you can also do that. So IP address are useful to communicate or to connect to our servers. And IAM role, we will understand what is IAM role. Okay, I'll just probably in the next session I'll just tell you what for IAM role is used. Don't worry for now. You can skip this for now. And shutdown behavior. So you wanted, like, you know, you have created an instance as a server, and while you're working something on that, somebody else who has an access to your management console, your Amazon's management console, unfortunately delete the server, it will be a problem because you'll be losing entire your data. So you can just, you know, safeguard it. Like, let's check this. So what we have done, so whether you wanted to stop or direct terminate, if you just go with stop, it will provide you an option of, you can stop it and start it later on. And if you just select this terminate, then you will have only one option that you can permanently terminate this instance but not stop and start. So that is what shutdown behavior. I'm sorry for that. So let it be stop so that you can stop it and start whenever you wanted in the future. Then this is what I was telling, like, if somebody delete, okay, and if you don't wanted it to be deleted by somebody, or you wanted to notify when you wanted to delete, then you can just enable or check this box, protect against accidental termination. So when you check this box, even if you manually or purposefully wanted to delete also, it will not allow you to do that. Okay, so it will say that you need to change your settings, then it will allow you to do that. And that's possible. So I'm going to see that, I'm going to show you that how it works out. So I've just checked that. Then monitoring, and every server, every instance will have some monitoring, like how, what way its CPU level is going, how healthy that server is, how you can access, how its throughput is going. So all that stuff. By default, you'll have default monitoring with that. And if you wanted detailed, apart from default, detailed monitoring, if you wanted, then you can just check this box and that charges additionally. Okay, so don't go with that. Let it be, because we are not going to, you know, have a server for a longer period of time, and then we're not going to do something so huge so that we wanted some monitoring and all. Then tenancy share, run shared hardware. So we can just, you know, get a hardware that can be shared to people and all. I mean, like, shared hardware is used, so that's not so very important. But what you have to understand in this case is number of instances you wanted, VPC, if you have your own VPC and wanted to launch a server in that, so you have to select that, your own VPC and subnet, then IP address and all. The next, so we did not do anything apart from just checking that termination, accidental termination protection. Then this is what I was talking to in storage. We automatically take 18 GB of root volume because our three-tier eligible instance is EBS only instance. It's nothing but it must require any base volume. It's just because this instance do not have any space by defaultly with that. So we go with that. The next, I'll just name this as my web server. We'll quickly launch a web server. I mean, create Apache, which we could not do yesterday. Okay, next. Then select the security group which we have created. It's that. We have port number 22, so we can connect it using PuTTY. Review and launch. We only have that. So meanwhile it's getting launched, we go convert our key pair from PEM to PPK. Okay, so for that what do we need? We need PuTTY and software to convert key pair from PEM format to PPK format. And what do? Just go load. Where do you have your key pair? It is an in downloads. You have to take all. You remember all these things? Go select your key pair which needs to be, you know, converted from PEM to PPK. Okay, it will suggest you to go with save private key command. It's fine. So this is what your, you know, key pair is. You see, you find so many, you know, combination of numbers, alphabets and all. So this is what encrypted, which means your key pair is by defaultly encrypted so that no one can understand what it is. When you encrypt your data, it will be like this. So go with save private key and here it is SSH-2 RSA. So it is just like a key. Are you sure you wanted to save this key without a place? Yes. Now, the naming convention should be same, except for the, what? The extension. So, manually I enter PPK. That's fine. We are done with that. So that we can check. So we have now our key pair into PPK format. So now let's go and try to launch. Find it ready. I'm selecting my public IP. You can connect your EC2 instance using your public IP or by using your public DNS complete name. You can find this public DNS name here, here, okay, this place, and you can also find the same public DNS name even here in this spot. Okay, so three different places you can find your public DNS name, but public IP is very short, so it's my practice to go with that. Now go. Okay, somebody have any issues connecting or launching instance, right? So check how do we do that. So paste your public IP address here, then go to SSH, go to auth. Here this is the point where you have to, you know, attach a key pair. So Sydney PPK. Why PPK? Can somebody tell me why PPK? Why not PEM? Yes. So we are trying to, yes.
Connect it to Linux.
Exactly. We are trying to connect to a Linux box. Yes, please.
We are connecting the Linux to Windows, no, sir. So we have to take PPK control.
Exactly. So my local machine's OS is Windows and I'm trying to connect it to a Linux box, so PPK format is to be taken. Then open, that's all. And what is the username? you must need to get this, say yes. Then username is?
EC2-user, yeah.
Exactly, EC2-user. So press in. Both Linux, what do you mean by both Linux, which means your local machines, OS is Linux and you're connecting to Linux box. It's like that. Then in that case, you can use PPM format key pair only. So now understand, we are in, okay, we are in, yeah, somebody's doubt. Somebody was asking yesterday how to, you know, get back to a normal user from a root user. Just type and exit and you'll get it. We'll see that. So now I'm, you know, I have launched my instance. I've connected to that. I'm now, you know, able to use my server, my EC2 instance for any purpose as I wanted and legally. And to execute, you know, I wanted to, you know, initially, whatever the, you know, AMI I have taken, I'm not very sure whether it is having all the updated packages or not. So I would like to update all of my applications packages. To do that, what do? I execute a command that is yum, okay, update. What do you mean by yum? Yum is actually a repository. Okay, it's the central location for all the Linux excuse me, boxes where you'll have all the softwares placed in that central location or repository. Whenever you wanted to update some application or software or you wanted to install for the first time, you use this yum command. The moment you say yum, automatically whatever you are requesting, it will go to that central repository and it will get back to you with all the updates and or if you are installing things for the first time, it will install. Which means in Windows machine, when we try to, you know, install some application, what we do, we just get the .exe file, like executable file, then we execute it, we run it by double clicking on that, then say next and all, right? So that's how we download it from somewhere, some location, but here we do not download anything. We directly execute because every single software will be there in this centralized location, that is yum repository. Now I'm updating all of my applications, so yum update, and in between it will ask me whether to continue or not, so I have to say yes. Rather I say somewhere in the middle, I'm just doing it initially. So go yes. But you see, I'm unable to do that. It's just because I'm a normal user. When you wanted to execute some command being a normal user, you have to, you know, get some permission. To get that permission, you have to use another thing, that is what sudo. So every single time you execute a command, because a normal user will not be authorized to execute all the commands, just because of that, you have to use sudo. Sudo will get you the permission to use or execute a command on behalf of a root user, in terms of a root user. So in order to do that, every time using sudo, I myself turn as a root user from a normal user. So how do I do that? Sudo su, which stands for switch user. So switch user to, when I do not give anything, it will take me to root. If not that, if you wanted to, you know, log in or turn yourself as a particular user, because a Linux box or a server will have so many users access to that. Okay, for example, me Mohan, I have logged into this machine as a Mohan. And if I just wanted to convert that into, you know, I just wanted my authentication to somebody else's authentication, like I have logged into this box as Mohan, but later on I wanted to change that to Sai. So what do I do? Sudo su Sai, so that it will get you, it will turn you as Sai from Mohan. But if you don't give any name, it will by default take, okay, root, the owner. So now you became owner root user. How do you understand whether you are a root user now or a normal user? That's by symbol, the symbol. The symbol when it is hash, which means you are now a root user. When it is a dollar symbol, it is just a normal user. Are we clear with that? Now I'll go and execute the command again. Yum update hyphen y, which nothing but yes. Now it will not ask me whether yes or no. So it's updating. That's fine. Once it's done, we'll quickly install Apache Server, Web Server, and whatever we did yesterday, we'll do that again and try to launch try to connect that web page over internet. Fine, we have updated all the packages. Now I'm going to install things, and to install again I have to use yum command only, but I'm going to clear my screen. So to install a web server is nothing but Apache, and Apache server's name here is yum, the command used for installing something or updating something. And the web server is what? HTTP, this is what the web server, the Apache server. Okay, sorry, before that I have to mention install httpd hyphen y so that it will not ask me to go continue yes or no. So yum install, that it's completed. But once it is installed, you have to check whether its services are running or not. That's pretty important. So how do you check services? Service, okay, whose services you are going to check? Your Apache server services, you are going to check whether it is running or not. So httpd, and you're going to check, it's nothing but status. You say that it is stopped by default. So when it is stopped, you cannot access this web server over internet. So you need to start it. How do you start? The same command, service HTTP, but instead of status, you say start. Then it's okay. Let's go check the status now. It's running. Fine. Of course it is running. Now I just wanted to, it's like, whenever you install some application in your Windows, it will ask for a reboot, just like that. Even here also, rather we reboot our server. Here, we reboot this Apache server here, our main server. Instead of rebooting main server, this Apache server will reboot. How do we do that? For that, we use another command, that is thk, check config. I'm just rebooting that web server, check configuration. So it will check all the configurations from the beginning and boot it again. Check config, thk config. Okay, this is the command I'm using, httpd. Which server I need to check the configurations of? That is what my web servers things I need to check. So httpd and on. So when you execute this command, it will reboot our web server, Apache server. Yes, it's fine. We are done with that. We have successfully updated our instance or our servers packages. All are up to date now. And now we have installed a web server into it. That is Apache server, that is httpd. Okay. That is a daemon. D stands for daemon. So that daemon will help us to install things. Now let's go create a web page, because whenever we try to access this web server, there should be some web page so that we'll get that information over there. Now where do we create that web page? Okay, where do we create everything? Like how in our Windows machine, whenever we install something, it will go and get installed in C program files, C drive program files, etc., etc. Here also you'll have, there we'll have drives, folders and all, folders and files. Here in Linux, we do not have folders, but the folders concept, I mean folders, we call them as directories. Okay, directories. And when you wanted to go into a particular directory, you always have to use a command cd, change directory. Now why I'm going to a particular directory? Because whenever you install a web server, Apache server, that Apache server will have a default directory by itself. So in that default directory, you should go and create these web pages, then only those web pages will be accessible. If you create somewhere else in some other location, they are not recognized and they are not accessed. That's why I'm going to the web servers, the Apache servers default root directory. Root directory is nothing but where it's originally located and where we need to create its webs, web pages. So that root directory is what? Slash. Always directory will have a slash starting with. Excuse me. So slash var, this is one directory. Under this directory, another directory, that is slash www. Under that, another one, that is HTML. So we are going to this part. HTTPD is a web server, Apache server's daemon. Daemon is nothing but what? It is a package where you can, install it directly. Somebody speaking something? Raghu, you're talking? Raghu, I'm not able to hear you. Could you please speak something louder? Hello? Fine. So remember, Usman, remember that this HTTPD is a daemon to install your web server. To install your web server, Apache server, this is the package we use. HTTPD is the package we use. So we're going to its central location. Okay, now from EC2 user, you entered into HTML. So this is where you are now. So to check which directory you are currently, we use a little command that is pwd, which is nothing but present working directory. So which directory you are in now? Var www.html. This is the directory you are in now. So now I'm just clearing it. Fine. We have installed, we launched the server, updated all the packages, installed web server into that. Then we entered into that web server root directory. Okay, this is where we are going to create, in this we are going to create our web pages. So how do we can create our web pages in multiple ways, but I use this way, I go this way, that is by using vi. Vi is a command which used to create a file or to edit an existing file. So I'm going with that vi, and the file name, the web page name, I'm just trying to give a default name, that is index dot. All the way the web pages should have the extension of dot html. Okay, so that I'm just giving vi name is index dot html, so that it understand, okay, this is index dot html is a web page. Create. The moment you say yes, okay. And when you are trying to create some file using vi editor, okay, this vi is a command, we also say that it is as a vi editor, because the only one option, we can create files in any possible ways. There are 2 to 3 possible ways you can create a file, but to edit an existing file, we only have one option, that is VI editor. That's why we say VI command as VI editor. And in this, you need to know some different commands here. To write something here, always you have to say press escape. Okay, press escape button so that you'll just see underneath the last line index.html new file. Then press semicolon. So shift that button. So colon you have to escape colon. Then press I. That will take you, okay, escape I, not colon, escape I will take you to insert mode, okay, escape and I, so that you can insert anything. Now I'll just type something, hi, hello world. Okay, this is what a simple text I'm just entering randomly. Okay, then after once you're finished, you're done editing it or writing whatever the stuff you wanted, then to save and exit from this, come out, we use this escape colon, okay, W for saving, Q for quitting it, and exclamatory symbol. So this is what you need to give to come out, to save this file and then come out. Remember that. Escape colon, W for saving, Q for quitting it, quitting from that this file, coming out of it, then exclamatory symbol, press enter after that. Yes. Then now you say yes, list, ls stands for list. So you wanted to check something, you are going to list all these files. What and all the files created. Now we have created one index.html file. So that is what you are able to see. And if you wanted to check what is in that file, what data you have in that file, you use command more. Okay, more is the command we use to check what data is there in that file. So that is what more index. I'm not typing fully. I'll just press tab so that it will take automatically. Tab. So enter. So what we have in that, hi, hello world, that is what we have written and this is where it is. Now, yes, fine, you have built Apache server and you have created a web page in its root directory. Now, the point is we need to access this web page over internet. How do we do that? Excuse me. Go take its public IP. Copy it. Take a new page and paste it. Enter. Do we get this now? Okay, are we able to access our web page? Say yes or no. See, the result has come. Now we are not being able to access our site, our web application, our web page. This is what we faced yesterday. You know, you got the reason why we could not able to, you know, connect to this. Can somebody guess and tell me why we are not able to access this web page? I just initially told in today's session, I told it. Yes.
Because of the security group.
Exactly. In the security group, we have taken our inbound traffic as only port number 22. So, you can access this server only using port number 22. But when we are trying to access over internet, are we trying to connect using port number 22 only? No. So, when we are accessing over internet, it will take another port number. So that port number should be, you know, given in the security group inbound traffic. We should set that. Then only we'll be able to access. Guys, you're still being idle in the sessions. I wanted more interaction from you people. Only one or two guys are being interactive. So you wanted to understand things clearly. Better you know, be active and then clarify your things or share your things. Now what do? I'll just go change my security group. Which security group? Whichever the security group which is assigned, we have taken for this. So the security group. So here this security group I'm going to change. So where do I go change? Inbound traffic. This inbound traffic should be changed. As I said, security groups are stateful. Whatever you edit will be, you know, functioned on the spot. You'll see it will be affecting on the spot. So go add another rule. What rule we have to add? You wanted to connect to internet, I mean access over internet, but that you have to take HTTP. So this is what the, you know, inbound we have to set, and HTTP always access using port number 80. Okay, anything you wanted to access over internet, you should have port number 80 enabled. Only then you'll be able to do that. So go save. And you don't need to remember any port numbers. By default, it will come. That is the pretty good thing in this. Now let's go and refresh this. See, we got our web page. What we have written, hi, hello world, we got it. So this is the simple thing we missed yesterday, so that we could not get. Clear, are you clear with this? Now, somebody's question that how do I come out from a root user to normal user? Just press exit. I think I lost my connection. So normal user, and from root user, if you wanted to become normal user, then just type exit, that's all. So when you say exit from root, you become a normal user. Okay, are we clear with this? Now after this, we discussed yesterday, we discussed about volumes, okay, and how do we, you know, create volumes and attach those volumes, and then, you know, we have seen so much of stuff and we probably have some time, I guess. Shall we go continue with that? Thanks. All are clear with this? What do we do is, now let's go discuss about volumes. So tell me, what do you mean by volume? The first question is, I'm saying volume, 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 but what do you mean by volume? Can anybody? See, if you just look at this, we have seen instances, different type of instances, on demand, spot, reserved, we have seen about that. I will discuss about AMIs little later, but now we are trying to understand EBS storage, elastic block storage. Under that, we just discussed something about volume yesterday, and after that we will be discussing about snapshots, how they are used. Of course, we discussed something theoretically, but not practically. So we will see things again, once again, theoretically and practically. Let us take a bit time but understand everything without any doubt. So volumes are nothing but, understand, it is just an
storage.
Additional storage, exactly. Storage capacity, yes. So what storage capacity your server is currently having now? Do you have any idea? What storage capacity your server is having? it is just 8 gigabytes of storage your server is having. Because we have taken, while we launch an instance, we have taken only one volume, that is as root volume, which is of 8 gigabytes volume we have taken. Alright, so in that 8 gigabytes, it has captured 1.2 gigabytes of space to install OS and all the softwares. And what's available now, 6.5 gigabytes of space is available. What if this space becomes full? Okay, what if it becomes full in this situation when our servers, you know, storage turns totally full, we go attach, create some volumes, additional storage, and that is to be attached to this. So the volumes are nothing but it's just like external hard disk. Okay, it's just like external hard disk. We create and attach it to this so that we can extend our storage and utilize it. Okay, so let's go see how to create a volume. So to do that you need to go to volumes. Okay, we already have a volume here. That is, okay, a root volume, so that I'm just naming it. Everything can be tagged here in this, and every instance can have maximum of 10 tags. I'm talking about instance, not about volume. Okay, so everything, you can tag instances, you can tag volumes, you can tag, it's nothing but names, you can provide a name. And you can tag security groups, every single thing, whichever you create can be tagged. Okay. So this is what I'll just only show you how to create a volume here today. After that I'll just show something else, and then we'll end up our session because it is 8:50 in India, 8:50 a.m. So as we are planned to end up our sessions by 9 o'clock. Okay, so create, how do we create? So go create a volume. Don't worry, I'll just discuss about different type of volumes again if you have any doubt, but for now remember there are three different type of volumes. Of course these two are recently introduced, so if you consider these two, there are five different type of volumes we have. And we always usually go with either general purpose SSD or magnetic. So these are the two two type of volumes which are eligible for free tier account. And remember, you cannot have more than 30 gigabytes of space or volume attached or used by you using your free tier account. You already have 8 gigabytes of space or volume utilized, and now you can only take 22 gigabytes of space additionally. Of course you can take any amount of space, but that will charge you. So in order to play safe, better be less than 30 gigabytes. But anything you create, end of the day you delete it, come back to scratch. So now I'll just go take some 10 gigabytes, which I'm going to delete again because I'm not going to check practically attaching it to the server and see. That I'll show you tomorrow. So go create. But make sure whichever the region or zone, availability zone, your instance is created, the same availability zone your volume should also be created, then only you can attach it to your server. So it is in AP Southeast 2C, so you are creating your volume in AP Southeast 2C availability zone only. Okay, so yes, create. It's creating. After once created, it will be available. Okay, and once it is available, you can attach it to your server and then use. When it is attached to your server, then it will be, its status turns to in use. Now it's still under continue creating state only. Meanwhile, what do? We see what is our IP address is. Our instance IP address is public IP. It is, I'm searching something in volumes. So our instance IP address is what, 52.64.113.41. So the same thing is here. As I said, every time you stop and start. Okay, I'm stopping it. Yes, stop. This will go up. It has gone, no problem. I'm not going to access this now because I'm going to delete it. It stopped, and when it is stopped, you see there are no details seen here. Monitoring, everything will be complained. Details, when you go to descriptions, you will see, of course, you having it, but when you just stop it again, let it go completely stopped, stopping. Till then, you'll see, yeah, it's available. Okay, it's available. Now, when you wanted to use this, you need to attach it to your up and running server, then make it recognized over there in that server. After that, you will be able to use that. So how to attach? Select that volume, go to actions and attach the volume to that. That server, whichever is running currently. Now I'll go to instances. Let's check whether the instance is stopped. Okay. Why we stop? Why do we have this option? You see, for example, you have an organization which works only from morning to evening, like from morning 9 a.m. to evening 6 p.m. Okay, you only, you know, run your servers during that particular period only, because they charge you for these instances or servers for the amount of time you are using them. So amount of time you are using them, you are using only from morning 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. So better you stop while you go to home, while you're going off of office, and start it when you come back to your office, so that you can safeguard your instances and pay only for the amount of time you use. But the challenge is every time you stop and start. Okay. You see, all are deleted. There is no public DNS. No public IP, only a private IP is seen here once it is stopped. Okay. I will go and start it now. Yes, start. What is the IP it has earlier? 52, 64, 113, 41. Now let's see what IP will come. And now just tell me, can I terminate this instance? Can I? Say yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Any other answer? Anybody else? Yes. Two inputs. Two of them are saying yes. Rest? What about the rest? The third input also says yes, I can terminate my instance.
Yes, you can terminate instance.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Now it's running, you see. What do you mean it has unzoned to storage, Usman? What you are trying to tell me?
Say that we have a storage to attach to it. We have to unzone, we have to detach the storage.
You do not to do that. You can directly, once you know you have a pen drive attached to your laptop, when you are not shutting down your laptop but you wanted to, you know, remove your pen drive, you go to, you know, this and detach or you know, remove from that. Okay, it's not currently, there is nothing attached to it. But when you are shutting down your computer itself, do you need separately need to detach that and remove? Not needed, right? So same thing, even though you have an additional volume attached, created and attached to this instance, you need not to detach when you want it to terminate. You can directly do that. I'll show you. I'll show you here. Okay, we have whatever the volume we have created, I'll go attach it to our running server. What's running? There is only one server running. And if you wanted to make this as a root device, just go say yes SDA, then it will be a root device, but not attached. Let it get attached. what I'll do, I'll just go and try terminating it. Selected already, that instance is selected. See, it's giving me a warning. What type of warning is that? On an EBS backed instance, the default action is for the root EBS volume to be deleted when the instance is terminated. Storage on any local drives will be lost. Of course, that's a warning. That's a simple warning. But am I able to terminate? This yes terminate button is grayed out. I'm not able to do that. Why? Are you sure you want to terminate this instance? Of course, but I'm not able to do this. The only thing I can cancel, I cannot terminate this. Do you remember anything? We have checked something while we launch our instance. Anybody?
Permissions.
Okay, you see we have attached the volume and that is in use. We have checked.
Yeah, we have made a checkpoint there.
Yes. Accidental termination, right? We have enabled accidental termination. That should be disabled. You got my point now? So what I have to do, how can I do that? Go to instance settings. Okay, under that, change shutdown behavior. Oh no, I'm sorry, not that. Under instance setting, okay, change termination protection. We have enabled termination protection and that should be disabled here. Only then you can delete. You clear? Now you are able to do that. You see your volume, your newly created volume is attached, but still I'm trying to go and delete it, terminate it. You'll be still able to do that. Now go terminate. Now you see it is highlighted. You can of course delete. It's shedding down. So that is what. See, if you think that server is very critical, okay, in a minute or 2 minutes I'll end up this session. So if you think your server is very critical, it is in live production, okay, and needs to be accessed by people are accessing to it, then usually we select this termination protection. We enable that so that nobody else can fortunately or unfortunately or accidentally delete it, and where so many people affect with that. So are you clear with all the topics we have discussed today? Could you understand anything? Any doubt?
Yes, no doubts for now.
Okay, as I said, guys, I have given you my contact number. As you said, you have a WhatsApp group about our AWS. Please add me into that so that you can discuss any doubt it arises while you practice. Okay?
Okay.
Few of the guys who are in India already have a group and I'm part of that. So it's especially for you guys who are in out of India. So do that please. And if you are fine, we'll start. So what we do tomorrow is we'll just go ahead and see, create everything again, because I'm terminating everything. I've terminated my instance. Now go check your volume. There will be only one volume removed, and this volume which is recently created by ourselves separately, it is staying as it is. So you have to be careful. Delete everything. Okay, delete volume so that you are safe, will not pay anything. And if you don't understand anything, you just go to dashboard. It will give you all the list of what and all you have, how many running instances you have, how many Elastic IPs created, how many snapshots you have, how many volumes you have created and running are you in use, whatever it is, everything you'll be able to see here. So you can also just go check and then do something there. Okay, clear? So tomorrow we'll see, we'll create a volume, we'll attach it to our instance, and see how do we use that, and from that we'll also see creating snapshots and all. We'll play with the snapshots and volumes tomorrow totally. With that, we will be finishing half of our EC2 session. So after that is done, we'll be remaining, we'll be left with load balancer and launch configuration. That's nothing but auto scaling. These are the two very important topics. Okay, so we have to understand them very clearly. Don't worry, I'll just go as slow as possible and then make sure you understand. But please be interactive, clear all your doubts on the spot whenever it is possible or whenever you have something in your mind and be doubtless. Fine guys, then catch you tomorrow. Okay, I'm going to end up the session for today. Bye.